Hello. Good outdoor, as we say in duties. Well, when I first thought about what I'm going to say here, I thought about the Germanic language like a zoo. You walk along, this is an animal, this is another animal, and you pass by all the animals. Some are big, some are small. Then I wasted or used 3 months on writing music instead. And 2 weeks before I came here, I thought now I had to do something about this lecture. And at that point, I wanted to do it like a historical tale, the tale about how did the Germanic languages come to be, how did they come to be in those places where they are spoken now, and why are some not documented better. So, let's see. Did it function? No, it has to be.
Turn it around.
Turn it around, like that? Yeah. Ah, yeah. Those four persons were among the first to make historical linguistics with tree structures and all that. The one to the left, Rasmus Rask, is a Danish person. The others are all German. And that's why most of the terminology in this field would be in German. So I deplore not speaking in German, but I made the choice and forgot about it, and then I had to stick to it. The one down to the left is Franz Bopp. He's not really known for making the structures, but he made a lot of the arguments used by the others. Rasmus Rask was one of the first to make tree structures that integrated Sanskrit with other Germanic languages. The two persons on the right, they spent their life collecting folk tales, politically incorrect folk tales from Germany, but the one to the right was the one who made the theories about the Germanic language, the Indo-European languages in the form we know them now. And the man named August Schleicher invented the word Stammbaum, the genealogical tree. We have here the part of the Indo-European languages that does not comprise the Germanic languages. And most of it is irrelevant, but you will notice one thing. You will notice that the Slavic languages are on the part of the Indo-European languages, which we know as the Saturn languages. Okay. The men before, they invented the notion of sound change. A sound change is a change that affects all sounds of sound categories in a language, and they should do it without any regard for grammar or meaning or anything. They just change certain sounds to some other sounds. And a sound in some Indo-European languages, which we guess maybe something like Q, W, was changed into S in some languages, and into, we'll see it later, into a K sound, written C, in others. And this part of it shows that Russian and the Baltic languages belong to a totally different branch than Germanic, if you use this model. Albanian is also here, but most of these languages are from Asia, and some are extinct, like I think we have got here Old Russian, and we have got, yes. You see Albanian to the right, but most of those are irrelevant, but it is interesting for the Germanic languages that they are not really connected to the Slavic languages as close relatives. This is the part where we find the Germanic languages. And the word, of course, kentum, that's the Latin word, but the word in itself is not important. The important thing is it shows the result of a sound change from what we expect to be a common sound like Q, W, or some, I don't know how it is said, but all those languages must have had a sound change at some point of time where they made this transition. Later we'll discuss where did those people live, and you'll hear about that in the next time. Tocharian is dead. It was spoken in Central Asia. Hittite is about the first documented language from the Indo-Pyrenean group. It was spoken about 3,500 years ago and then went extinct. And Osco-Umbrian Latin, you see Osco-Umbrian and Latin as if Osco-Umbrian was children of Latin. That's not the case. It was they were on the same level. Latin and Osco-Umbrian were contemporary languages. They're not, this is wrong. But now we take the Germanic languages. You see a division between Western Germanic, Eastern Germanic, and North Germanic languages. The North Germanic languages are mainly those in Scandinavia, and Eastern Germanic, we'll come to that, that's Gothic. And Western Germanic, that's you see the group will be divided into two a little later down, between High German and Low German. I'll say a little about that, but let me just say first, the people of Reich Grimm found out there were two big changes. One named as the first great sound shift, the other the second grand sound shift. The first defines the Germanic languages. You can say when languages have been through those changes, they belong to the Germanic branch. Maybe they are not Germanic yet, but they belong to that branch. And if they are not part of that branch, they must be part of some other branch. The second divides Low German, that is Plattdeutsch, from Hochdeutsch. And there's a line called the Binnenrad line, where they say above that, they didn't pass through the second change. So they are not part of High German, they're part of Low German. We come to that later. And you will see also Yiddish here, put on the same branch as modern High German. On the other branch, you see Frisian and English. And I have a couple of words to that because I may not agree with all authorities on that point. So everybody remembers those languages now, I hope. Okay. This is how Schleicher made his first Stammbaum. Actually, this is easier to read. He was not really one of those people who used the Kentum Chatham distinction, which shows there is a certain measure of uncertainty and, well, it's not, it doesn't stand on totally secure footing, because he said that Balto-Slavic was related to Germanic. That's not what I said a moment ago. So within the theory, there is some room for discussions. And we'll find later that some of the sound changes may be contradicted by things said by other authors. They may see there was no sound change because they're looking at some other words maybe. We look now at the version with I showed here. That's the one I'll be referring to because that's the newest and the one that has been accepted by most people. But again, the word kentum is not important. What you do is you find some words you expect to be both in the parent language and in the children, the offspring languages. And then you hope that they were there and they passed through those changes. And words which were imported after the change are totally irrelevant. That's the idea. And if it results in a nice table like that, we should be happy. Yes, everybody should be happy. No, not everybody is happy. The dialectologists, they are not happy. Because they know that if you have a large area where language is spoken, leave it to itself, then it will develop into a dialect continuum. Where one influence will start in one town or one village, another influence will start out from another, and then they will meet somewhere in the middle, and a third will start a different place. You cannot integrate dialectology in trees like that. They have sound changes, but they are localized and they are random and goes in all kinds of directions. So a tree is really only to be seen as a macro level, where all the small differences have been weeded out. Well, small differences get weeded out if somebody kills them. That means to get a uniform language which shows the differences you see in after a sound change, you have to kill some of those differences. You have to kill some dialects. You have to use it by force or by mass media. So there must be some unifying things that make a language survive against all the other variants. Otherwise, you would get a dialect continuum that stretched all over Europe. You don't see that. You find a hard line between northern and southern Germany. You find a, no, not now, but earlier. You find a hard line now between German and Danish. Well, it was not there if we go back, say, 800 years or something like that. But it develops because of politics, because of migrations, because of mass media and things like that. Let's continue. Doop, 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 doop. Well, how do you trace populations? One of the things that may be the explanation that we have got something like languages, fairly homogeneous, unitary languages, may be that they were developed by a small group of people who were on the move and highly military, so that they could conquer an area and impose their language. And we will see that again and again in the history. This part of it is about genetics. How do you follow a population? You can use archaeology. Of course, you use ways to find ages by calcium, what is it, carbon-14 and things like that. But nowadays, we have got one tool more, one important tool, genetics. We have in every cell in our body, there are some 46 chromosomes or something like that. And they are paired. One pair is different. There's a Y chromosome, there is an X chromosome. The Y chromosome is only males. It is transmitted from father to son, and from son to son to son, and so on. There is no way any chromosome from the mother can enter that. So if you follow those mutations that happen to that Y chromosome, you can make a tree that is totally impervious to change from any female. That means you can trace populations by looking at how many mutations of a certain kind are in a certain area. If you want to know the matrilinear lineage, you use something different. Yeah, sure. What?
mRNA.
mRNA, yeah. Yes, mitochondrial RNA, yes. Mitochondria are small beings that invaded our cells some 3 billion years ago, and they've got their own RNA. That comes from the mother only. No father involved, but it is transmitted to both sons and daughters. So there we can also make a sort of stammbaum. And that means that now we can start out discussing where came the different groups of persons from that now speak certain languages. And combine that with archaeology, we can begin to see a pattern of how different language groups went to certain areas, imposed their languages, and why some areas have their totally own language. Like here, there is a Finno-Baltic N group. It turns out that the Finns have totally different genes from the Swedes and everybody else in Europe, except Russians. It's like a totally different population. They have not been touched by any of the migrations happening in the time we go back here, about 6,000 years or something like that. The Finns may have been there together with the Sami for at least 6,000 years for that matter. We cannot say exactly how long, but that's the time frame they are speaking about in Finland. Hungarians arrived about 700 AD. That's different. They arrived at so late a period that we don't have to discuss it now. We come to that later. And then we see an Western European R group and Eastern European R group. The Western European R group, I have a suspicion that can be equated more or less with the people who are from the megalithic culture. We'd come to that. That's the perspective now. I'm not going to speak about all of those. We go here, you see how, according to a map, I think it's Wikipedia, I've forgotten the paper with the sources somewhere, I don't know, somewhere in the town. So I cannot say where I got it. But those haplogroups exploded somewhere in the Middle East and then spread to the west and to the east. And that reminds us about the stamp bound for the Indo-European languages. Now, there are two main theories about how the Indo-European languages or where they came into being. The main theory is the Kurgan theory, proposed by a Lithuanian archaeologist who noticed that many words that were common to a lot of Indo-European languages had something to do with horses. Okay, which culture would have horses early? Well, in the area just north of the Black Sea over to the Caspian Sea, there was a place where there were a lot of horse owners who rode around, and they say that would be the logical place for the Indo-European languages to have arisen. But that was only based on archaeology at the time and on some shared words. The other main theory has been that it all started out in the northern part of Turkey, but in fact there's so little difference between those in our in terms of distance that it could be either. If it had not been for the genetics, I would say I would not know whether one of those, which one of those was the correct one. But, and now we have this, we just skip a couple of, this is simpler. A couple of years ago, some geneticists traced the genes of Danes back to when the very oldest skeletons were found in Denmark from the people who arrived there just after the Ice Age up to about the year 1000. And then they found something interesting. There is the word Yamnaya. They found Danish haplogroups, as they call them, the genes are divided into haplogroups, are from three sources mainly until that year zero. There were the people who arrived just after the Ice Age. Then about 8,000 years ago, another group arrived. Those people had another group of genes, and they were more like in family with those of Western Europe. Those people came at about at the same time where agriculture was introduced into Denmark. And that cannot be a coincidence. At the time where the first population was sitting around the base and eating oysters on the kuchenmøddings, then the agriculturists took the inland and began to make wheat of other corns there. And the two groups coalesced, and they became actually connected to a big culture. I'll just there. Megalithic, that's a map of where you find megalithic constructions. And Denmark is at the upper end, and I would say Sardinia is at the bottom, and in between you, we find people who made Stonehenge and Karnak and all that. That culture existed until about 2800 in Denmark. And then it disappeared as a flash. Before we had something we called funnel ceramics. Suddenly, we are a member of a family group making corded ware, another kind of ceramics. And those geneticists now have found some interesting. The people that came to Denmark at that time are closely related to people in the Kurgan area down north of the Black Sea, those Yamnaya, which were shown just a minute ago. And now it's not a discussion, was Denmark invaded? Yes, it was invaded. The discussion is over. No politically correct archaeological excavation can disprove that we were invaded by people from the area north of the Black Sea. But it happened in a way where a large section of the population still continued their old culture, the Yamnaya, and a mixed culture, corded ware, existed north of that, including in southern Scandinavia, in Germany, and into Little Russia, and into Russia proper, and along the coasts of southern Scandinavia. Well, who were these Yamnaya? It's fairly certain to say that these persons brought the Indo-European language to Northern Europe. Because where else should they come from? The Indo-European languages have spread out from this area, not the Black Sea, or maybe from Northern Turkey, but they cannot have come from Western Europe. They must have come there. So we now know with absolute certainty almost that the culture that brought Indo-European language in some form to us came from the Germania culture. What about then Italo-Celtic? What about Greek? Well, they may have come from the same area, but not necessarily in the same wave of migrants. And actually, the genetics show they didn't. They may have come from the same general area, but not from the same group of persons and not at the same time. So we can say somewhere in that corded ware area, the Germanic languages must have appeared. It cannot be in Western Europe, it cannot be in Scandinavia before the year 2800. There's another year which is interesting in this connection. I just look at the watch. Okay, we have time. That's when the Bronze Age starts in Denmark. That's much later. It starts about 2000 BC in England. They've got Cornwall to give the tin. It started also somewhat earlier in Northern Germany. About 1700 BC in Denmark. There is no reason to believe that the invasion started came at that moment. We can see that the people who were supporting the Bronze Age culture in Denmark were basically those who had arrived during the preceding 1,000 years from the south. And we can say one thing more based on archaeology. Some of the best flint smiths in the world made their stuff in parallel to those who made bronze. They were not some population who was discarded or put down or a slave or something. They tried to compete and lost the competition, but they were there. So I would say Bronze Age in Denmark does not imply a change of culture. There's no reason to believe that it implied a change of language then. It could be, but we don't. We have no reason to believe it. The next, then 1,000 years pass and nothing happens. Nothing happens. We go to, that's the spread of the chariot. But this is from the Bronze Age. The Vikings did never carry helmets with horns, but we have helmets with horns from the Bronze Age. Just as an information for those who have seen funny Vikings with horns. No. This is the migration about the year 1000 of the Western European. It is concentrated in France, in northern Spain, and in the middle of Europe. That's where that gene, that haplogroup is most represented. That's about the same area where the Celtic group was strong. The Celtic group is first documented in Hallstatt about 600 before BC, and then it spread westwards and eastwards. So they formed a group in the middle of Europe, a border where the Germanics couldn't penetrate. Next picture. That's a Hallstatt culture. That's a Celtic culture. Then we've got the red up there. That's probably where Germanic arose. It may not be in Denmark, I may be Danish, but I'm not that nationalistic. It could just as well be in Hanover or somewhere. But the culture there was an Iron Age culture. The Iron Age started around 700 BC after some bad weather and other things, and there were a lot of migrations. The best bet I can give for when the Germanic languages went through the last phase, at least, of the Germanic big sound shift would be something like 500 BC, plus minus 200 years or something like that. At that point, we have defined the Germanic language, proto-language, which then divided into two. Well, okay, that's the Grimm's law. I don't expect you to just see what that means, but it's an illustration of the sound shifts. It happens in three phases, so it must have taken some time, and also it must have happened in a very small area with a very small population, otherwise the whole thing would have been a mess. So my guess is it happened in one little place, and that group migrated, or they came to as invaders or something. They spread the Germanic, real Germanic language. Now we speak Germanic, Proto-Germanic, which is Germanic. They spread it to their neighbors. This is another way of writing it. You can see we have got, for instance, the word here, BH, that's a V sound like in Spanish probably, and it became B and P, and it ended up as F. I'm not going into details with the exact changes, because then we wouldn't be finished here before in a couple of hours, and we have not time for that. This is a change that show an addition to the sound loss, and this is just the time frame. This is how some of those groups migrated around the year 200 down and attacked the Romans, just to show we have got migrations in the area. Some of those went outside the area, but you have most chance of having a big sound shift if there's turmoil in an area. If people go around and some suppress other groups and they spread the language they have invented while migrating, and I believe that's one of the reasons. This spread of the Germanic languages happens in that time frame. That must be where the Germanic group as such was created. We go now. This is another map of almost the same thing, showing first that Poland spoke Germanic at that time. Well, they don't now. This is a map. Well, I changed it slightly, you can see. But for once, I said where I got it from. It is how the languages are divided. And you can see the East Gothic. I'm going to say a couple of words about Gothic, because that's interesting.
And North Scandinavian languages, West, again, divided here in Anglo-Frisian and Dutch German.
And I'm not sure about that. I'll say some words about that. I don't believe it happened like that. This is probably the oldest word in a Germanic language recorded anywhere. It's a helmet found down in southern Austria, and the word you have to look at is Heigast. It looks surprisingly close to the words you find on, for instance, the golden horns found in Denmark, something like that, 300 years later. But it's a Roman soldier of Germanic descent. It's almost certain with a name like that, he might have been a Goth coming down, getting a job in the Roman army. It states in which part of the army. It's in the Illyrican part of the army. He got his helmet and wrote on it, I'm that name, and I serve under this company. So, then about 350 years pass before the next attestation of Germanic, and that happens in Denmark, but we are going to see something slightly newer before that, namely the famous Wulfila Bible, which has been preserved in one manuscript and a couple of fragments, but only half has been preserved. And there's one poem, I think it's Gerins or something like that, a few short inscriptions, but by and large, we only know the Gothic language from that one book. And it's not easy to read that. It is an alphabet probably invented by himself on the basis of a Greek and maybe Old Slavic, I don't know. But now some of you who speak Greek will know what the first word after the colon, the semicolon is, anapauson, and it can be seen he just imported it almost directly into his text. And then you start thinking, because there are many examples of this, how authentic is that translation? How does it represent the real language of the Goths? The Goths didn't really write anything except this, I'm not sure that he wrote exactly as people write. I would say it might be heavily influenced by Greek, but it's the best source we've got for how the sounds were, and that's probably the only thing you should trust. You shouldn't trust the grammar, you shouldn't trust, you cannot be sure about the dialect here. But they were later divided into Ostrogoths and Westgoths, into two groups. The language of those two groups later is not attested, apart from a few names. Here, what happened is that a person named Attila and a group of people named the Huns came and destroyed a big kingdom stretching from the Baltic down to the Black Sea under King Ermanric. It was smashed in the year 75, and the Goths fled, or they joined the Huns or the Romans. Some may have fled to Denmark also. But basically, they took the flight down into southern Europe. The Ostrogoths, they took over Italy, but were forcibly removed by Justinian, the Great of Byzantium. And Visigoths were removed as a cultural factor by the Arabs. Those people didn't write a single word almost in their own languages. They wrote in Latin. And because of that, we don't know about those languages those spoke. The Burgundians are interesting for one single thing. You may have heard about the Nibelungenring. Those who listen to Wagner will know about the Nibelungenring. They are fairly certainly describing events from the Burgundians, also a Germanic group fleeing the Huns. We go on. This is the oldest example of a Germanic language outside that helmet we saw a moment ago. The oldest from about 100 and, well, I remember my memory, 35 or 40 or something like that after Christ. It is written with the older Futhark. That's a letter, an alphabet, runic alphabet with 24 letters. 24 letters which later were reduced to 16. That alphabet, there are about 600 inscriptions, mostly short, but that means we have documented the next phase in northern Germanic very well, because we know some words in it. We can say how the sound laws went, and we can find out even some details about grammar. This is a very famous find from Denmark. They are supposed to have been made about 200, 300 after Christ. Some say 400, but it's a debate. They have been stolen and melted, but before that, a man named Worms made a drawing. So we know the text, and it says something like Ek Klavagas Diacholtias Tornornu Tavido. And Tavido, the meaning of Tavido is debated. It can mean I, Legest, Lavagas Dier, made this horn, but it's who would entrust the goldsmith to set his own name on a horn. It can also mean I, Holtigas Dier, from Holtia, of the family Holtia, sacrificed this horn. And there's no way to know, because that word has disappeared. It's important, however, because you see there's a lot of letters in the name Glavagastis. Notice also Gastis. This is a language that disappeared around 200 to 400 and became later replaced by Old Norse. It's the version of Nordic languages before Old Norse. And I look at the words, okay, a couple of minutes yet. So that's the oldest language we have presented, apart from one name on one helmet. That Old Norse there. Okay, did I write here? And not whispering. Around 200, 300 in Denmark, there were a lot of clashes. What happened there is almost certainly that we were invaded by Swedes. And when we hear the Denmark is called Denmark now, the original tribe there is has come from the east. And they have thrown out more or less the Jews, the original Jews from Jutland. And now we have something of a little, well, this is, there are a couple of hundred years where almost no runes are written. And when they arrive again, right with the runes, it's only 16 runes. And the language has become much more short and pregnant. Short. Short. The words have been cut down to maybe 2/3 of their length. This happens, and now this is actually an example of Old Norse. It's a grammarian from about 1200 on Iceland, who was one of the most smart grammarians of any time in any period, together with Panini and the Grimm brothers and Rasmus Reis. He wrote a grammar for the Nordic languages where he told us, for instance, that it is important to have letters, and what happens if you don't have letters for the sounds of the language. And then he wrote about some of the sounds in Old Norse, which we didn't know except through this text, that they have naturalized vowels and things like that. But this is, if there are any Icelandic people here, please don't correct me. If you remark, I have in the first line here, London, you can see there is a little thing below the O. That shows this is an Old Norse text. If it had been modern, it would have had Faroese, Danish, it should have, no. Okay, if it has been a newer text, then you would have had two dots over, or in Danish, you would have a line over the O. But they have changed on that point, and they've changed on very few other points. Therefore, Old Norse is 90% the same as modern Icelandic, I would say. Modern Icelandic persons would read this as easily as an English person would read, I'd not even say Shakespeare, but the generation after Shakespeare, as text from the tale of the 17th century. It's no problem for them to read sagas in the original text. That's just examples. I don't have time for that. We go to, now, that's old English, Anglo-Saxon. And I have about 5 minutes to say something about that. I'm not sure I will get ever to German. But normally we say that English is very closely related to Frisian. Maybe, but Frisian is only documented around 1200, very late. And the Venerable Bede, I think maybe I have got, this is from the Venerable Bede who wrote about 600 in Latin, but this is a text in the Wessex dialect of Anglo-Saxon, to the left. This says clearly in, the red words, they say clearly there are three groups coming to England, Jutes, Anglos, and most importantly, the Saxons. There is not a single word about any Frisians. The Frisians did not invade England. They may have migrated there during the preceding centuries, but they did not invade England. The king there, a lot of kings, in Vortigern invited Hengist and Horsa, two Saxon knights, to come and help him against some enemies he had got, and then they took over most of Great Britain. Well, they didn't get their salary, okay, they took the country. And then we don't see any texts in that language before this, and a little later we get Beowulf, which doesn't describe anything happening in England. Beowulf is entirely about things happening in Denmark and mostly in Jutland. If you look at the names there, compare them to what you find in Saxo Grammaticus and other sources, those are all Danish names. And there is a discussion, I don't know, somebody in Sweden has said it could be Göteborg, that Geats, D-E-A-T-S, the Geats might be the people coming from Göteborg or something. But if you follow the names, the king names, the genealogies of Danish, fictive maybe, but names known from Stark and other sources, then they correspond to Judy's names, Judy's kings. So it has been even been it has even been suggested that the main seat of the king attacked by Beowulf and by the Grendel the monster was living just outside a town I've lived in for about 20 years. I'm not sure about that, but the short thing here is there's not really a proof that it is Frisian that gave rise to English. It must be a Creole language probably created from Saxon and Anglo, the language of the Anglos and the Anglos, the language of the Jews, and then the Frisians may have contributed, but not as a ruling group. The rulers were from those other three tribes. So, and that's not, oh, didn't, that's the wrong one. Now we did really arrive. I'm not going to say much about the Anglo-Saxon. You know all that it was in, the country was invaded by the Normans who spoke French, and while they were ruling about 200 years later when they started to write in English again, it had become Middle English, basically. And they lost all the inflections almost, threw them out, and now it was a new language.
Well, that's so well known, I'm not going to say much about this. This is a map of Germany around the year, or maybe 200.
Ptolemaeus was stationed in Alexandria, so this is second-hand information. But it is fairly precise. It says where the Saxons, the Saxons and the other groups mentioned by Bede lived at that time. They were in place already when he wrote. That's why I used this North Frisian example. I don't have time to get through all the versions of Frisian, and that not that. But this may be because you see here that there were two groups linguistically around the year 450. Important thing is here: all of France had been conquered by a group of a group called the Franks. But this is what happened outside France. The Franks quickly switched to speaking some kind of Roman, which became French. But this is the first part of what happened in Germany. And the first German, the first French text we've got, that's Proto-Germanic and so on, that's from about 700 and, in the middle of 700 and something, where a couple of the descendants of Charlemagne were discussing some problem. But back. The part below is an attestation of how German looked at that time. Around 800, and that below the upper part would be in German as it looked then. And this happened then. A lot of the sounds changed above a line known as a Benrad line, which goes around Hanover to the Ruhr area. North of that we have got Low German, south of that we have got High German. And High German has spread to all of Germany now, pushing Low German down to being almost a dialect, but it's both a language. I think I'll stop here, because then you have a little time to questions, if there are any. One question only. Yes, but the Swiss Germans are further down even than the Southern Germans. They were part of this sound change. But what we have here is, for instance, that if you have a Low German word with a P, then it'll be P in High German, like Port, Pforte in the German, and so on. So if you also, there are other changes, like if you say Hus in Low German Saxon, then it's house in all the rest of Germany, until you get down to Allgäu, where we've got a lot of funny diphthongs. That's what we've got.
Pretty much it, yeah, 40 seconds. So.
40 seconds, very short one. No.